But there is something inherent about the idea in the human spirit that we want to stack and build high. We want to challenge ourselves to see what is possible. So I like the analogy that, or the experience that we've all had of watching a three-year-old take some blocks, and they're going to want to stack them up and see how high they can make them before they fall. And in fact, this is my son, and he, when I came down the other day, a couple months ago actually, he'd built this big tower and wanted his picture taken. There's something innate to us that we think this way, that we want to see what is possible structurally. It's somehow we lose that character when we're adults, but some people do, but kids have it. So the way I sort of, why this becomes a really big issue of what we can do is that we have a whole lot of things limiting us as designers to actually achieve the level of innovation that's necessary to build high. And the example I give is this. In British Columbia, the BCBC stands for the British Columbia Building Code, which is what I have to design to at home. We only recently moved from 4-story to 6-story. So we were allowed only to build 4 stories in wood. Now we're allowed to build 6 stories in wood. And there was a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of work with our government to be able to make this happen. I live in the heart of a huge forestry sector, so there was huge political will for us to see what we could do. But the irony is, by the time we had already got 6 stories passed in BC, and this is our current code, is 6 stories, a good friend of mine, Andrew Watt, already built a 9-story tall wood building in London. And shown that it could work. So if 9 stories can work, why does our code say that we can only do 6? It was a question I asked several years ago. But the thing is, I had sort of heard this story about 6-story while I was riding my bike across Japan with my son, and I just walked out of a building that was 19 stories tall wood, in wood. And the thing about this building is that not only is it 19 stories tall and built in a high earthquake zone and a climate very similar to mine in British Columbia, but it was also built 1,400 years ago, which really kind of shows you we have a huge problem with what we've done to create a cap, an arbitrary sort of glass ceiling on what is possible in our imagination, which is a fundamental flaw, I think, in the way our building systems, building codes work worldwide. So the other analogy and the way I like to talk about it is, can you imagine Cairo, if Cairo had said, listen, you can only build a 20-meter high stone building? Well, we would never have had the Great Pyramid. And the Great Pyramid stood for 5,000 years as the tallest building on Earth. And it was only replaced by this building. And if Paris had said a wrought iron building could only be 20 meters high, we wouldn't have had the Eiffel Tower. And the Eiffel Tower is the thing that really triggered the imagination of a generation that said, let's go out and see what now, after wrought iron, we can take ductile steel and look at what we can build with it. How tall can we make it? And every city on Earth has benefited from the reality that that density is good, from the footprint that we each make on Earth, that that density comes through height, and that our sense of inspiration and desire to create has resulted in the transformation of the world in this last century. So as we look at the building regulation, different countries of the world have set these same caps, these arbitrary, I think, are quite arbitrary caps on what is possible. British Columbia, you can see in the middle at 6 stories. Switzerland, very progressive building culture, and yet they went from 2 stories to 6 only in the last 3 or 4 years. So this is something that's happening worldwide as people are recognizing we need to move to a wood culture. So I was recently at a conference for a product called cross-laminated timber, which is something I'm going to get into in a minute. But one of the statistics that came out of that conference and discussion was that in Canada, if we were just to open up a window to move and allow us to build 6 to 8 story buildings more without the regulations, that we could almost double the quantity of output of our forests, which is a big deal. Now, our forests are suffering from the fact that climate change has caused a beetle that usually got killed off every year by the cold to spread, because it's not getting cold enough anymore throughout Western Canada, to spread and dramatically kill a huge amount of our forest. 15 million hectares of land, is dead now through the mountain pine beetle. And so it is transformed. Climate change is really seriously transforming our entire ecosystem and resulting in a lot of wood that we can today use, but a real question is about what we reforest with ultimately. I believe that if we go to high rise, it's not only opening up the door to using more wood, but it really is opening up the door for us to be able to look at something that really is a systemic change in the way we build all over the world, not just in timber cultures. And the reason that's going to happen is that wood buildings aren't really wood buildings the way we thought of them 20 years ago. We now have these mass timbers. We now take wood and glue it together in different ways in engineering systems that allow us to build with large pieces of wood. That's the really revolutionary change. And some of this stuff's not that revolutionary. The products have been around for 20 or 30 years, and yet we're now finally realizing that we can look at them in very new ways. So on the top, you see what's called cross-laminated timber. It's really simple. It's just boards laminated in different directions, makes them very strong, makes a big, thick panel that's very long span, up to 12 meters long. And this is revolutionizing the building industry in Austria and Switzerland right now. It's vastly increasing the market share of timber in those countries. But it's being done not just because wood sequesters carbon, it's got a great story there, but because it also creates really healthy living environments, really cost-effective structures, really safe structures. And I'll go into that in a second a little bit more. I talk about a material called LSL, which is a prevalent material as well, and it comes in pieces up to 19.5 meters long in North America and even longer in Europe. And I'm going to show you a system that we've invented in my firm called FFTT, which is a way of building with these products to build buildings up to 30 stories tall. I'm going to show you that in a sec. And we believe quite confidently that we're going to be able to get to 40 and 50 in the next 5-10 years with the way we're working with it. We need to experiment some more, but we're getting really close, which is obviously, first of all, the tallest in the world, but also a indication that systemic change is possible. So the beauty and the elegance of this product, LSL, is that it's made out of small pieces of wood. It's made out of, instead of these solid pieces of wood up here that come from older growth species, this is made out of small growth species, or faster growth species. This is made out of poplar and birch, and these small pieces allow us to actually harvest at a much more rapidly renewable kind of pace of trees that are only 10, 12, 15 years of maturity rather than 70, 50, 60, 70. That's a huge, huge issue, and I'll get into it in a sec. What I basically think, and again, I'm still just an architect in Western Canada, so I don't have a research institute. I don't have, we have some great friends that I tap into within the forestry sector, but we're still learning every day. This is a table that they have about the net change in forest area by country. And you can see when you look at Australia and you look at Brazil, these are the areas that have seen, the most loss of forest land in the last effectively just 5 years, right? So the question really becomes, okay, if we know that part of our way of tackling climate is going to be about finding ways to reduce deforestation and actually look at afforestation, we need to create economic incentives for that to happen. And some of that's going to be through good, but I think following on Bjorn's lead, it has to come with an economic incentive. And my hope is part of that economic incentive is rethinking the entire way we think about forestry and the kind of products that we ultimately make. And so what we're researching is actually not just the species that I know in Canada, but tree species and what their potential are to become part of this LSL, that laminated strand lumber kind of technique, which will allow us to build in these other countries. Because going back to that beginning comment I made about world housing, and climate and the relationship of the two, the vast majority of those 3 billion people that need a new affordable home are in the developing world. And today, those homes are built in concrete. And those homes are typically, very often in the poorest nations of the world, built really poorly. And that means in hurricanes or cyclones, I guess you guys say, and earthquakes, that's why we see the scale of devastation that we've seen. What's interesting is that wood buildings, if you look at Haiti, wood buildings survived the best of all the buildings that were there. And that's because wood tends to not fail quite as catastrophically as concrete buildings do. But also, it's because wood behaves in a very predictable way. In the developing world, sadly, a lot of the time, corners are cut in the way we build with concrete. People pull out rebar at the last minute to save a few dollars. And as a result, buildings you can't see from the outside, they appear to be strong, are not nearly as strong as they need to be to behave well in these catastrophes. And so we've developed a system, and I'm going to really speed through the last slides here. But we've developed a system called FFTT, which is a way to build very fast, very cost-effectively, using these large panels of wood, both using that cross-laminated timber product that I mentioned, as well as using the laminated strand product that I mentioned, and build buildings that tilt up effectively, where the pieces are quite simple. Where we reduce the number of physical connections in the building, which is where the costs of buildings really come from, with this desire that ultimately we'll be able to initially design and engineer buildings and ship them from timber nations to nations in need of this housing component, but over time also develop by changing the products, the types of tree species that go into laminated strand lumber, and encouraging plants to make these kinds of products, to look at how other developing nations can build their own timber sort of industries to be able to build these types of buildings. But I won't really go into the technology, but the good and exciting thing for us right now is we've engineered already to 30 stories. We have a grant right now from a group called WEC in Canada. And we've also shown how they behave in fire successfully and shown how they behave in earthquakes and high wind loads. And these are thoroughly engineered structures that are coming, and hopefully in the future, the skylines will look like this. And there's a little Einstein quote at the end there, but that's it. Thanks.